Hey there folks, how's it going? Any excuse for a party is a good one in my book, and here in the UK the whole country has been given a pass and an extra day off work this year for the King's coronation. That's right folks, Charles has passed his probation and is about to become a fully fledged king, and we're all invited to join in the celebrations with a street party, weather permitting, at which we'll serve the official dish of the coronation, quiche. Quiche? Quiche. Like his mother before him, and probably kings and queens before that, I don't know. His Maj has announced an official dish of the coronation, and it's out with the spices and sultanas, and in with the eggs and broad beans. The coronation quiche is taking centre stage at street parties across the land. Now this recipe has received, let's say, mixed reviews in the press, but the only way to really know if this is a quiche fit for a king or a right royal mess is to make it, so let's get into it. To get started, we'll need pastry. Now you can buy a ready-made shortcrust for this if you like, there's no shame in that, but it's easy enough to make our own and we can up the flavour and flakiness factors a bit if we do. The official recipe doesn't make enough pastry in my opinion, so I'm doubling up here, and in my tests, that worked perfectly. I'll measure out 250 grams of plain or all-purpose flour into a large bowl, and then I'll put that to one side for a second while I weigh out the fats. The official recipe suggests we go with 50-50 butter and lard here, and who am I to argue? Now we're not sticking to the traditional half fat to flour either. I'll measure out 50 grams each of cold butter and lard. Now it is important that these be good and cold, straight from the fridge. If you don't have lard, or you want to make your quiche vegetarian, then you can just leave out the lard and use 100 grams of butter total. I'll just chop those into smaller dice for easier mixing, and then add half a teaspoon of salt to my flour before dropping in my fats. The usual pastry rules apply here. We need to work this quite quickly with cold hands, rubbing the fat into the flour with our fingertips. Now this is pretty tiring on the old fingers, but it doesn't take too long. This took me maybe 3 minutes. Now what we're looking for is for the mixture to be roughly the texture of breadcrumbs or builder's sand if that's your thing, and we do want to make sure there are no big lumps of fat left. A few smaller ones is fine and will help add crumbliness to the pastry, but for quiche, big lumps of fat can result in filling leakage, which, trust me, is a mess you don't want to have to deal with. At the same time, we don't want to overwork this or let it get too warm, as that will result in tough pastry. As I say, about 3 or 4 minutes and this looks fine. Next, I'll get about 4 tablespoons of milk. This is about 60 mils, and working in 2 or 3 batches, I'll add that to the pastry. I don't know why I use a spatula here, just use your hands from the start and it'll be one less thing to wash. It is worth adding the milk bit by bit like this though, to help it spread more evenly through the flour. But if you want to just dump it all in, then go for it. Just be sure you've got an evenly hydrated dough ball at the end. So next, I'll just mix that around with my hands until it just comes together, very lightly kneading with one hand until it leaves the bowl clean, and that's done. Overworking is another sure path to leathery pastry. This is looking great, so I'll just wrap it tightly in plastic wrap and pop it straight in the fridge to chill out for a bit, at least half an hour to 40 minutes. While that does its thing... Sorry. Hello?
Hey there, Ross.
How's it going? Oh, hey, Ross. How's it going? I'm just out doing some research for a future video. Look, never mind. We've only got 20 seconds for this whole bit. That's not important. Are you recording the video right now?
Yeah.
I'm doing it now.
All right, cool.
Well, don't forget to ask people to thumbs up, you know, like, subscribe, all that stuff.
Right.
Engagement's super important right now. Ooh.
Yeah.
No, remember to like, subscribe. Are you there?
Hello?
Aha! Gotta go. Bye then. While that does its thing, we can make a start on our filling, and for that we need spinach. This is just some baby leaf spinach. The recipe calls for 180 grams, but it doesn't specify whether that's the fresh weight or the cooked and squeezed weight. I went with the former, but in hindsight, I wish I'd had a bit more, so maybe start with about 200 grams. I'll give this a good rinse in cold water to remove any dirt. Feel free to skip this if yours is ready washed. And then I'll fill up my kettle, or boiling vessel of your choice, and boil up some water. Now this doesn't need much cooking, so I'll just leave it in the bowl I washed it in and pour in plenty of boiling water. You can see it begin to wilt immediately, and I'll just leave that in there for 2 or 3 minutes until it's softened and pliable and a good bright green colour. Once done, we can just drain it and shock it in cold water to stop it cooking and fix the colour. Now some say you need ice water for this, but I find cold tap water works just as well, but you do you. Finally, now it's cool, I'll drain off all the water and then squeeze out as much as I can, first with my hands and then with a bit of cheesecloth. A tea towel works too in a pinch. Then I'll just go back to the board and mow through this with my knife, chopping it up as coarsely or finely as you like. The recipe recommends quite coarse, but I decided to go slightly finer to make it easier to spread evenly throughout the quiche. Now we need to cook some broad beans. I won't lie, this seems like an odd choice for an official quiche to be served in May, given that broad beans aren't actually in season for at least another month. But again, I'm a mere peasant, it's not for me to argue. Oh, and don't get me started on the egg shortage, I'm choosing to gloss over that completely. Now that said, I obviously couldn't find fresh beans in the shops, and lacking a means of time travel, I had to revert to frozen. Not a major issue, as with most frozen veg these days, these were probably flash frozen mere minutes after harvesting, and so are technically fresher than their fresh counterparts. It also saves me podding them, so win-win, I guess. Now the recipe specifies 60 grams, a couple of ounces of these. I just went with a handful, which is probably a bit more than 60 grams. Just go with whatever feels right to you. These need to be cooked, so for that I'll get another pan of water boiling. I use the kettle again, and I just drop them in and then let them cook for 5 minutes or so until tender. Now obviously I could have used the same water for the spinach, but for the video I wanted to do the steps separately. Feel free to multitask here when you make this at home. Once they're cooked, I'll do the same thing I did with the spinach and shock these in cold water to stop them cooking. Without this, they'll carry over very slightly and might be overdone by the time we come to assemble the quiche. At this point, you could double pod them if you like. They have a slightly tough, somewhat bitter outer casing that, if given a bit of a squeeze, will give way to the bright green beans inside. For this dish, I want them to have some bite, so I didn't bother, but if you want to put in the extra work, then by all means, have at it. Once that's done and my pastry has had a good rest in the fridge, it's time to roll it out. This is just the usual process, lightly floured surface, roll and turn until it's slightly bigger than your dish and about 5 millimetres or 3/16 of an inch thick. I'm using a loose bottom flan tin today to make my life easier and there's no need to grease it, although your mileage may vary with other types of dish, so use your best judgement. Once I've got it rolled out, I'll roll it onto my pin and lift it onto the tin before gently easing it into the shape and taking care to get it into the corners and fix up any holes that appeared while I was rolling. Now make sure you fix those holes well or you'll likely experience filling leaks, which again will ruin, at best, the quiche, more likely your oven. Just grab a bit of pastry from the excess and use it to plug the gap, then use another bit of spare pastry to go around the base, pressing everything evenly into the tin. Finally, trim off the excess, dock the base all over with a fork to prevent steam buildup while it bakes, and we're good to go. Now, Mary Berry tells me that the enemy of a good quiche is a soggy bottom, and we don't want any danger of that today, this being for the king and all, so to that end, we need to blind bake this. For that, I'll grab a piece of baking parchment. There's no need to faff around cutting it into a circle unless you're feeling particularly crafty, and I'll scrunch it up to make it more pliable before gently placing it into the flan tin. Now to weigh this down, you can use baking beans if you have them, link in the description if you don't, but if you're like me, you always have dry ingredients sitting around, I'm just using some lentils today. Dried rice works well too, as do dried beans, the eating kind. I'll just pour in plenty of the lentils to completely cover the bottom and weigh the pastry down, and then I'll give it a quick shake to even them out and place it in a preheated oven at 190°C or 375°F for 25 to 30 minutes. This is longer than the recipe suggests, but I did find when testing this that the times in the recipe are a bit on the low side. So 25 to 30 minutes later, I'll pull this from the oven and remove the lentils along with the parchment, and then I'll pop it back for 5 minutes just to let the base dry out fully. While that happens, we've just time to mix up the filling, and for that I'll strip the leaves from a handful of fresh tarragon, and then I'll just mow through them with my knife to finely chop. Next, I'll grab a measuring jug and add 125ml of whole milk and 175ml of double or heavy cream for a total of 300ml of liquid. That's just over half a UK pint or 0.6 US pints, if that be your unit of measure. To that, I'll add a strong pinch of salt and a generous twist of black pepper before cracking in 2 eggs and giving everything a thorough mix. Finally, in goes the tarragon, and that's the filling sorted. Next, I'll weigh out, only because this is a royal quiche, you understand, about 100 grams of mature English cheddar. Feel free to substitute a local variant here, but IMHO, you do want something with bite and sharpness. I'll pull the pastry from the oven, and it's nicely baked at this point, with the base just barely starting to brown. It has shrunk away from the edge of the tin slightly at the top there, but that's no problem. The main thing to check is that it doesn't have any holes. Turn down the oven to 160°C or 320°F and then grate on half of the cheddar directly onto the base while it's still hot. Ensure that's spread around evenly and then top with the cooked spinach and beans, again ensuring even coverage. We want to get as close as possible to every bite having a bean and a bit of spinach. Pour over that filling mixture carefully, trying not to disturb the beans and the spinach too much. If necessary, you can give this a gentle stir once the filling is in, but I prefer to avoid that as I'm pretty ham-fisted and it's easy to damage the pastry when stirring. Finally, top the whole thing with the other half of the cheese. Sprinkle over a small pinch of salt to help with browning, and then very carefully move this over to your oven to bake for 30 to 40 minutes until set and lightly browned. And while that cooks, there's just time for me to catch up on what's going on with the king. But I'll be keeping one eye on that quiche. The official recipe suggests 20 to 30 minutes, but I found again that was far too conservative. Just keep an eye on it and let the colour be your guide. Once it's done, it should look pretty much like this, and it should still have some jiggle to it when lightly shaken, almost like a jelly. This is the hallmark of a good quiche, and it will set a bit more as it rests, resulting in perfect doneness by the time it's ready to eat. And that's it. Once it's cool enough to handle, push the loose base up from the bottom and either dig in and enjoy it hot, which I can recommend, it honestly it's delicious, or cool it completely and put it in the fridge ready to serve at your coronation big lunch. Whether you're a royal fan or not, I hope you make the most of the extra long weekend. Do try this recipe, don't believe the hype, it is actually pretty good. And check out this video next for another party friendly recipe that you won't want to miss.